a couple of the things that have not changed in branding and in marketing over the last 10, 15 years, and how those things might just help us navigate the next 10, 20 years in marketing and brand building. In my career, in about 15 plus years at Amazon and P&G, I've run the full gamut of branding and of marketing. I started on the prestigious Bounce fabric softener sheet brand, growing that business 20% year on year, so I really started at a high, and I went downhill from there. A number of years later, I shot a bunch of commercials with Tiger Woods, and we're ready to go to air, and
oops,
the theme was how Tiger was a champion both, you know, on and off the golf course as a human being, and that was the exact week we finished the editing was an unfortunate week for him and ended up being an unfortunate week for us too. So I definitely learned how not to do marketing and how not to construct a message. And over the last 5 years, I've been between Shanghai and Seattle, helping to build a digital marketing organization for a greater China organization, and then leading a couple divisions at Amazon in Seattle. But I'm really excited to be here all 2 weeks of my experience in Vancouver. But I think, you know, over the course of the last 10, 15 years, I think a couple key themes have really emerged that are common threads that haven't changed throughout the times. And I think we see those in all of the... Is that okay? We see those in all of the executions that have been successful, whether it's 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years ago. And you have yours and I have mine. And I think... the brands and the businesses that have found a customer insight that's really powerful and found a way to communicate that insight in a really heart and mind opening way have been successful. And I think it's really important for us to keep those things that haven't changed top of mind as we think about moving forward. And it's easy to say, but hard to do. For this reason, there's just so much noise in the system and so much change that's happening. You see, you know, just an absolute explosion of options from a product and marketing distribution and from the speed of change and the data that's available to us. And those things are just creating a ton of noise and a ton of distraction for us around that are at times pulling us away from those two key themes of what is that powerful customer insight and how do we communicate that in a mind and heart-opening way? And you know what's making it worse is at times the industry is incentivized to focus us on the noise. And I'm sure you do too. But I get calls constantly on how you know my business is in real trouble because my Tumblr campaign is failing and I need to completely reconstruct a campaign starting from scratch around Tumblr and gosh, I just think that's totally backwards. I think the medium kind of figures itself out once the message is clear. And so my advice is as you build brands and as you build businesses across North America and beyond, is to start right here, and ask yourself the question for yourself and your business. How is your brand and your business helping other people achieve their goals? And it sounds pretty straightforward and it sounds pretty easy, but it's super hard to do, and it takes a while, because inherent in this question is knowing, gosh, you know, what is important for my customer? What are their goals? And what's the priority of those goals? What's important to them? And can I build a product and can I build a message that supports that product that really meets that goal in a best in the world type way? And then can everyone in my organization be able to communicate that goal with consistency? Because I think that's really important. And so, you know, often when we've been successful, it's been when we've started and put the most time researching, investigating this question. And then moving on to the second point, because I think once you've identified how your brand can help others achieve their goals, you know it when you found it. And it's amazing how your product roadmap and your messaging strategy just starts to come together and surround and surround that that mission almost in an effortless way. And then, you know, and then the next challenge, which doesn't require quite as much time as the first, but nearly, is how do you communicate that in a succinct way, both your product and your message, in a way that has a unique point of view, and that opens the minds and ideally the hearts of your customers. And I think for this to be true, your customer really needs to be the hero of that story. And so you see a lot of stuff out there that's entertaining and that's fun, but if the customer's not the hero, and you're not really helping them or helping someone to meet their goals, then it doesn't really matter what medium comes forward. And then last is the medium, because there's so many out there to choose. And gosh, I think that should be intuitive, and I think that should be the easy and the fun part. And if it's not, there's lots of folks that will call you up and offer, you know, their help and their assistance to find the right medium and to construct a message and a story around that. I lay it out like this, with a concerted effort around spending a lot of time on that first question, because I think too often it's the opposite. And if you see a lot of content that's out there now and a lot of discussion, it's what's your strategy on Pinterest, or what's your unique strategy on Facebook, or what's your unique strategy here, and how do you build that from the ground up? And I think, you know, if you've got a couple hundred million dollars in your marketing fund and in your product fund, then that could be a reasonable thing to do. But there's probably only, you know, a handful of brands in North America that have that. And so if you're building small and if you're building scrappy, it's much more effective to spend the time on the hard stuff. And gosh, you just know it when you see it, because as we look at what's really been encouraging to me is, as you look at the marketplace, some of the best executions of this are also some of the newest entrants in the brand game. And I think Google's doing just a really fantastic job. GoPro's doing a fantastic job, and probably Airbnb is the best. And we're going to watch a little film of a recent execution from Airbnb. Go ahead and play that. And I think this will bring to life some of what we just talked about.
Dear stranger, when I booked this trip, my friend said I was crazy. Why would I stay in someone else's house? But this morning, a city I've never been to felt like one I already knew. Everyone in your neighborhood was so warm and friendly. And your home was perfect and peaceful. Oh, and then I met your friends. They reminded me of my friends. It felt like I had known them for years. It was almost like family. I just wanted to thank you for sharing your world with me. It felt like home. Airbnb, belong anywhere.
That's great. So, I think that that's just, it's such an obvious, did it play again? It's such an obvious a spot when you watch it, but the amount of work that went into to creating that message and to building the product and the communication around it, centered at the, you know, putting the customer as the hero of that, is pretty incredible. And I heard today they're apparently doing a lot of things really well at Airbnb. I think they've raised another $1 billion on a $24 billion valuation. So gosh, there's just a lot of things happening well there. So, you know, it's easy, you know, sometimes to connect the dots looking backwards, and it's super hard to do that looking forward, again, because of all this noise that's in the system that you really have to focus on pushing to the side. And so I wanted to share one more example before I go of a process that we went through where we struggled out of the gate. I was living and working in China, and just as background, it was on the Gillette business, and not involving Tiger Woods, fortunately, but But there's in China, there's 400 million men that shave, you know, 2 to 4 times a week. And the majority of them use this really crappy electric razor, which produces skin problems and a whole host of other challenges. And so we thought, you know, we could really help them achieve this goal of better skin and a better experience with our product and just try it again and again and again. But we just, you know, I probably spent $2-3 million before just giving up and realizing that I was too focused on, there's a lot of excitement in China around social media and the different mediums that you could look to. And I was missing the big picture. And so we went back with customers and spent time and tried to listen to guys around China describe what their goals were. And again, we still couldn't get there. And one of the guys called me from the research center and said, hey, Joe, we need a bigger facility because all these guys are bringing their girlfriends. And so we thought, well, why not just interview them and find out if they play a role in shaving? Maybe they do, maybe they don't. And if they could offer us any insight. And then we heard from this girl, and we'll play this interview. And I think at that point we knew that we had something to grab onto.
通常就是男朋友比如说剃胡子的时候你会觉得他很性感因为就是男生的脸部的线条本身就是比较有立体一点然后呢剃胡子的时候打上那种白色的泡沫会把那个线条勾勒得更加好更加立体然后你就会觉得说就那个味道就出来了他那种男人的味道就出来了 对的，心里面的话，我就是会觉得，首先我就是觉得你还有一种就是想要去抱住他的冲动，因为就觉得说，在那一刻好像，觉得他更加 attractive， 更加吸引到你，然后呢，你也会觉得说自己更加有这种，就女生的这种味道，然后想要跟他契合在一起，所以我觉得在那一刻就是说，感情似乎就是有一个小小的升温或者那种感觉特别好。
So it seems pretty extreme, and if it was just one customer, we would have been like, eh. But there was dozens of these, and there was a real need and a real opportunity for us to leverage the young women of China to help amplify our message to the young guys of China who just weren't getting it. despite my millions of dollars on Chinese Twitter, but. So we had to be, once we figured we knew it, we had number one, we needed to crack number two, which was, what's the right way to do this in a non-obvious, heart and mind opening way? And it was absolutely not to produce a TV spot, but I think it was really to start a movement and see if this was something that could, you know, gain traction and take a life of its own. And if it would, we would jump on and go forward. So I'll show you what we did, and then we'll go from there. So let's look at the last video. Sex bomb, sex bomb, yeah. You're a sex bomb. You can give it to me when I need to come along. Give it sex bomb, sex bomb. You're my sex bomb, and baby, you can turn me on. Baby, you can turn me on. You know what you're doing. Target, come and help me ignite. Love struggle holding you tight. Hold me tight, dog. Make me explode. So, never in a million years would I have predicted this is where we'd end up. But for some reason, it just worked like crazy, and the thing took a life of its own. And kind of true to form, we didn't even worry about the mediums because once this thing was out there, we were headlined in absolutely every single news media in China for multiple weeks in a row, and memes started, and just the whole thing took off, and we're able to then, in a very non-intrusive way, introduce the brand and the message. And that approach may not have worked in Japan, may not have worked in the U.S., but we had to know we were wrong and go back and start the process again. It was gosh, it sure was a lot of fun to do that. In the process, we probably helped, I think it was well over, and I forget the total numbers, but last I counted, it was over 30 million. 30 million men that we helped feel a little bit more manly and a little bit more masculine, and then we gave couples, young couples in China, something interesting to talk about. That's just one example. I think you'll definitely find the right strategy for you. I would just leave by encouraging you to just, as you build your brands and as you build your businesses, there's two watchouts. There's the noise that's there and that's always building, and it's super easy to get distracted. And as you organize your teams and deploy your resources, just be really conscious of where you're putting your efforts, and focus as much as possible on really getting to that point where your insight is powerful and you're communicating it in a great way. And then, the last thing I'd say is, people think about marketing, they think about brand, and they think that it's just the message. And it's obviously the message and the product that you build around that. And it's also the organization, because, the way your company acts is your brand. And I think now more than ever, probably more than ever in history, it's more about what you do than what you say. All of these efforts could go astray with inconsistent actions from anyone in your company, and just Google J. Crew and see what's happened there in the last couple of days, and I think that'll bring that to life. But I really appreciate the opportunity to come here and talk to you guys about shaving and China and branding, and I wish you luck in building your brands and building your organizations. Thank you.